Welcome again to the Milken Institute Forum. I'm Skip Reimer, Executive Director of Events and Communications here at the Institute. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping items. Just so you know, our next forum is on Tuesday, July 8th. Josh Ruxin, who is the author of 1,000 Hills to Heaven, will be here to talk about his journey from New York City and his life there to creating a new life for him, his family, and many local people whom he helped in war-ravaged Rwanda. It's a fascinating book he has written, Tuesday, July 8th. Tonight's book, People's Republic of Amnesia, is for sale right over here with our friends from Barnes & Noble, so please grab yourself a copy. Afterward, the author will stay behind and sign copies, so hopefully you will do that. As with all of our forums, we take questions electronically. You can either email us at the email address on top or text us to the phone number. You can do that anytime throughout the program. Now, before introducing tonight's speaker, I thought we'd just kind of briefly set the stage for what things were like in Tiananmen Square 25 years ago this month. So if we can show a very short BBC report on what it was like that day, please.
The noise of gunfire rose from all over the center of Peking. It was unremitting. On the streets leading down to the main road to Tiananmen Square, furious people stared in disbelief at the glow in the sky, listening to the sound of shots. There was confusion and despair among those who could hardly credit that their own army was firing wildly at them. This army was launching into an unarmed civilian population as if charging into battle. From Tiananmen Square, the sound of gunfire sounded like a battle, but it was one-sided. A line of soldiers was strung out facing a huge crowd. The air was filled with shouts of "Fascists, stop killing." Many came up to us, shaking with anger and disbelief and fear. "Tell the world," they said to us.
Now, it was pretty easy for me to find that video online, but as Louisa will tell you, it's probably a lot more difficult for anybody in China to find any video like that. Her book is about changed lives in a changed country, and it's a fascinating story. The Wall Street Journal said her book enhances our sense of human costs of suppressing the past, of dulling the young's understanding of their world and capacity for critical thought, of severing people from a homeland that they yearn for, and of trying to pretend that none of it is happening. Louisa has reported from China for the past decade, most recently as NPR's Beijing correspondent, and previously for the BBC. She was a member of NPR teams that won numerous awards for the coverage of the Sichuan earthquake in 2008 and the Beijing Olympics. She's also been honored by the Human Rights Press Awards. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Louisa Lim.
Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank the Milken Institute for having me. And I'd like to thank you all for coming on this beautiful sunny day when you could be at the beach. Thank you all for coming to listen to me talk. So I'm going to be talking about my new book, The People's Republic of Amnesia. And it's really about how the events of 1989 changed China and how China subsequently changed the events of 1989 as it rewrote its own history. It's about amnesia, which one very famous Chinese author called a state-sponsored sport. And it's really about the cost of not subscribing to that amnesia and what happens to people who don't play along with this state-sponsored sport. And my quest really started with this one woman. And this is Tang Deying. She's about 70 years old, and she lives outside Beijing, about 1,000 miles away, in a city called Chengdu in southwestern China. And she lost her son on June the 6th, 1989, and she never saw him again after that. And I met her by chance. And when she told me her story, it sort of got me thinking, and I started to wonder, well, what happened in Chengdu in 1989. And then bit by bit, I started to track down eyewitnesses who'd been there and documents and pieces of propaganda put out by the Chinese government to try to put together her story. And when I started looking and I started putting these pieces together, I realized that there wasn't just a crackdown in Beijing. There was also a crackdown in the city of Chengdu, but it was a forgotten crackdown, forgotten, never even known overseas, but forgotten in China, and even forgotten in the city where it happened. And that was the kind of central question that really bothered me when I started to look at the events of 1989, is that these were events that happened 25 years ago. That's living memory. You know, how can something that happened in living memory be forgotten? So that was one of the questions that I wanted to answer. And one of the first things I realized is that memory is geographical. So this is the picture that we all think of in the West when we say, when we hear the words Tiananmen Square. And just as a small experiment, just please put your hand up if you've seen this picture before. It's almost everyone. Actually, put your hand up if you haven't seen this picture before. So that is actually 100% of people in this room have seen this picture. So just bear that in mind for later on. And I mean, this is a picture which really, in the West, we've kind of telescoped the entire Tiananmen movement into this one picture. But this image, powerful though it is, it doesn't really reference what came before. And what came before was almost 7 weeks of protests by students that were sparked by the death of Hu Yaobang, who was a former party leader and who was a liberal reformer by nature. He had been deposed 2 years ago, and he died suddenly of a heart attack. And the students were very sympathetic to him, and they came out in spontaneous mourning. That very quickly changed into political protests. Here you can see they're demanding freedom and democracy, but those weren't the only demands. They were also calling for more action against corruption, against nepotism. They were unhappy about wealth inequality. And so there were a whole host of issues that they were protesting about. On April the 26th, the government came down against the students. That was the first time it had really shown its hand, and it called the protests turmoil. So that was a sign, that was the first sign that the government was not supporting the protests. But it did not end the protests. In fact, they got much bigger. And by May the 4th, that was the first time 1 million people took to the streets of Beijing. There was a hunger strike, which started in mid-May. And there was also all this time, there was a power struggle at the highest echelons of the Communist Party. And this was the loser in that power struggle, Zhao Ziyang, who was the Secretary General of the Communist Party. And that was his final public appearance. In the early morning hours, about 4 in the morning of May the 19th, he came out in Tiananmen Square, tearfully telling the students, "We have come too late." And after that, he spent the next 16 years until his death under house arrest. That was his last public appearance. This is also forgotten in the West. June the 4th was not the first time that the government tried to send the troops in. In fact, they tried towards the end of May and sent thousands of soldiers in convoys of trucks. But what happened was the people all came out and stopped the trucks with their bodies. They just swarmed these trucks. They laid newspapers down on the ground and slept around the wheels of the trucks and refused to allow the trucks to go on any further. And often these troops, they were, in some cases, they were marooned in this sort of swarm of humanity for 3 days and nights in some cases. And they eventually had to withdraw because there were so many people in their way. So the students saw it as a major triumph, but it was only a temporary one. And as we all know, the final act of clearing the square happened on the night of June the 3rd to June the 4th. 150,000 soldiers poured in. The government was not going to be humiliated in the same way again. So they had overwhelming force. And no one knows still today how many people died that day. The deaths mostly did not happen in the square itself. They happened on the approach roads to the square. And the initial Chinese statistics said around 241 people died, which eyewitnesses said was far too low. At the time, the Red Cross said 2,600 people died, but they were told to withdraw that number under political pressure. And some people who were there say that was too high. So at the moment, we don't know. The number could be somewhere in between those. So the tank man picture, though it is the first thing that we think of, it doesn't really reference any of these events. But it has become, in the West, almost a shorthand to talk about protest. It's a meme which is really so easily understood that we see it again and again in different contexts. And I'm going to show you some examples. This is President Obama's first trip to China, 2009. And he's seen as a squeegee man begging for a handout in front of the line of Chinese tanks. This is from the same year, 2009. Young Iranians started protesting against election results, and they were using Facebook and Twitter. And as you can see, he's standing with a BlackBerry or something, tweeting in front of the line of the tanks. And the mullahs in the tanks are saying, he's twittering. And then this is from last year, and this is a comment on Edward Snowden fleeing to Russia. The irony of someone supposedly fleeing to protect our civil liberties to a country with scant regard for civil liberties itself. So in the West, we see these pictures and we understand what they're saying. But I wanted to know whether it was the same in China. After all, China now has 618 million internet users, and everyone is always talking about how the internet is able to break down the government's control of information. So I wanted to know whether that was, how true that was, and especially how true it was when it came to 1989. So I took the picture of Tank Man, and I took it around four Beijing universities. They were the four universities that had been most instrumental in the protests in 1989. And I asked students, you know, whether they'd seen this picture. And if they said yes, I would double check and see if they really knew what it was. And I was very surprised. Only 15 out of 100 students could identify that picture. So just remember, 100% of people in this room compared to 15% of people in China. It was a very crude experiment in a way, but I discovered very quickly that it was very effective. I mean, I could tell that most people who didn't recognize the picture really had no idea what it was, because there was actually a physical reaction to this picture. So if people didn't know what it was, they just looked at it blankly, and they would kind of peer in a little bit, and there was no flicker of recognition on their faces. And they would ask me questions like, is it Kosovo? Is it South Korea? I was asked as well. Someone else pointed out the lamppost, the street lamp at the bottom of the picture, which is very unusual. The only place they have these street lamps is in Tiananmen Square. And that student said, well, it looks like Tiananmen, but it can't be, can it? So it was clear that most people really had no idea. 85% of the people I asked couldn't identify it. And actually, out of 100, 19 people looked at it and thought it was a military parade. So that's more than actually knew what the picture was. And among those people who did know what it was interesting that several were quite defensive, and they really defended the government's behavior. They said, perhaps what the government did was cruel, but it was necessary. China would be worse off today if the government had acted any differently in 1989. So that's really a retrospective justification based on three decades of phenomenally fast economic growth. And it's also the government line. I think it's very mainstream, even among people who took part in the protests now. You know, many of them do believe that what the government did was necessary in order to allow China to become the country that it has become today. But it was a really interesting experiment for me as well, because I suddenly realized how nervous I myself was. I mean, I'd been a journalist in China for 10 years at that point, and I'd spent a lot of time, you know, doing the slightly dodgy things that you do when you're a journalist in China, you know, sneaking around police checkpoints, disguising yourself as a peasant, trying to go to Tibetan areas to report there, you know, all this kind of thing. So I'd done all of that, and yet there I was on these campuses holding this picture, and I just, you know, I was sweating, and I was nervous, and I was convinced that I would be detained or arrested just for asking a question. Have you seen this before? So that was when I realized that even I myself had internalized the Chinese censorship, and if I was so nervous asking people this question, given that I actually had a card in my back pocket which gave me a literal license to go around asking people questions, if I was so nervous, how much harder was it for ordinary Chinese people to talk about 1989? And that was kind of obvious when the 15 people who did know what the picture was, you know, often when they looked at it, as I said, they had a physical reaction. Some actually sort of shied away from it as if it was dangerous. You know, one young man gasped and said, oh my God. And there were two people who said they didn't know what it was, but it was so clear that they really did, because there was this shock in their eyes, and they both said, one of them said, it's too sensitive, I can't talk about it. And another one said, it would not be prudent to discuss this. So that really showed me how much of a taboo there is on talking about the events of 1989. So you might wonder why they don't know anything about it. Well, they're not able to learn anything about it in school. It's not on any syllabuses in primary school or secondary school. Even at university, you'll only learn about 1989 if you're a history major. And for example, this book, which is the book they study from, has 529 pages. Only four of them are about the events of 1989. And there was a French professor who found this book, and he looked at the account of 1989, and he actually said that it contained a monumental historical untruth. So even if it is written about, the version they're reading is objectively wrong. We're not talking about issues of subjective things. You know, it's a lie. It wasn't always like this. Right after 1989, the government couldn't immediately hide what had happened. So instead, they tried to sort of fill the information space. So they put out all this propaganda, books like this, The Truth About the Beijing Turmoil. And these were books that supported their version of events, that the student protests weren't protests, they were turmoil, counter-revolutionary riots that had been sponsored by hostile elements in the West aimed at bringing down the socialist system and the Communist Party. So there was a lot of propaganda floating around, and there was kind of wall-to-wall TV documentaries talking about what had happened. But nowadays, if you went into a bookshop in China and tried to buy something like this, you would not be able to find it, because nowadays, all of those versions, all of that propaganda has completely disappeared. So the government has gone from trying to fill that information space to trying to delete it entirely. And you can see this is another experiment that I did that shows that. If you put the words Tiananmen into Google here in the States, if you see all the images are of Tank Man, the second thing that comes up is the Wikipedia account of the 1989 protests. But if you do the same thing in China on Baidu, which is the most popular Chinese search engine, you don't see any pictures of Tank Man. You'll see pictures of Tiananmen Gate and tourist information about the square itself. So there is a big sort of censorship machine, an army of censors, the police, the Chinese internet. And one of the things that they look for and delete references to 1989. So there has been this great forgetting. And that's happened both at an individual level and at a collective level as well. And just one example of how widespread that forgetting is this picture. It was taken by a Hong Kong photographer on June the 4th. It's wounded students being rushed to hospital. And this picture was actually printed in a Chinese newspaper in 2009. And it was illustrating the profile of the photographer that took it. At this Hong Kong photographer. Slightly ironically, the newspaper article was titled, "I used photographs to record the journey China has taken." But the thing was that no one who was working on that paper, not the page editor or the picture editor or even the censors, no one recognized that picture, so no one knew to censor it. No one knew that it was sensitive. And this is not the first time that this has happened. There have been several mentions of June the 4th in Chinese newspapers. So I would say that that is a measure of both the success and the failure of Chinese censorship. It has been so successful that the institutional memory of June the 4th has pretty much disappeared. But the success of that strategy is now threatening the ability to continue it. And it's not just the Chinese press that is muzzled. I'm going to play you a very short piece of film which shows the efforts made to also control what the Western press does. So I just tell you what it is before you see it. This was from 2009, so the 20th anniversary. And every year when it gets to the anniversaries, all the Western journalists, you can apply for a permit. And the permit allows you to go and film on Tiananmen Square. So all the TV journalists do this, and they go and stand on the square, and they say, you know, it's the whatever anniversary, and, you know, the security's really tight here, and there are lots of policemen, and really there's not a lot else to report. And on the 20th anniversary, all the journalists went down to Tiananmen Square, and they discovered that there was this new security innovation trying to stop them from reporting in the square. I like to call it the umbrella men of Tiananmen Square. You'll see why. It is a good trick, but everybody, it became the story, because this is not the behavior of a government that is at peace with its own actions. This is the behavior of a government that is very insecure, some might even say paranoid, you know, that it tries to stop Western journalists from doing, you know, one minute stand-ups in Tiananmen Square. But in this kind of climate, acts of public remembrance are a challenge to the state's narrative, the dominant narrative. And the state will really do, you know, take almost all kinds of actions, as we've seen in the last month, to stop people from talking and to stop people from publicly remembering what happened. I'll just tell you a couple of examples, because these are people who I profile in my book. And this is a woman called Zhang Xianling. She's 76 years old, and she lost her 19-year-old son to an army bullet in the head in 1989. And together with another woman, she set up the Tiananmen Mothers, which is a group of relatives of those who died, who have spent the last 25 years lobbying for truth, accountability, and compensation. Three words that are all a challenge to the Chinese government. At the beginning of May this year, she attended a seminar. Those words say 2014 Beijing, June the 4th commemoration symposium. 15 people were present at this meeting, mostly academics, a lawyer, one of the Tiananmen mothers, and some dissidents. And it was a meeting that was held inside somebody's apartment. After the meeting, five of the people at the meeting were criminally detained on charges of creating a public disturbance, which is hard to do when you're inside a private apartment. But anyway, that aside, they were detained. Some of them have now been released, but at least one, maybe two of them, are still in criminal detention. And Zhang Xianling, the woman who I profiled, is sitting in the front row, the third from the left. She was at the symposium. She was questioned and then released. Another person who is in my book is this man, Chen Guang. He was a soldier in 1989, and he was one of the martial law troops who were sent to clear Tiananmen Square. He then became an artist. First, he tested into the Army Art Academy, and then he tested into the Central Art Academy. And for the last sort of 10, 15 years, almost everything that he paints has its genesis in what happened on that one night, June the 4th, 1989. It's almost like he's reliving his guilt in art. And this is a picture, and I'll play in a minute, a very short video of an art performance that he did at the end of April this year. So it was in an empty apartment, and he had had permission of the person who owned the apartment to use it. And on the walls were painted with dates, starting in 1989, and ending in 2014. And then he just whitewashed over the dates. So you can play. His explanation, he said, was, "History is like a blank. It has been wiped out." So for that act, which you just saw, this performance took place in front of a very small number of people. It was about 12, 15 people only who were present. But he is still in criminal detention today, and nobody knows what charges have been laid, if any. So this year, according to Amnesty, 114 people were detained or put under house arrest in the run-up to June the 4th. 47 people were criminally detained. So this year, even more than any other year, the message from the Communist Party is very clear. The message is, this is not something that can be remembered publicly or even privately. You know, for the first time, people trying to commemorate this in private spaces have ended up being detained. So the message is very clear. Next year, I think people will be far less willing to talk to Western journalists or to anyone about what happened, because there is a price. I mean, I won't talk about these the people in my book, but each of their stories is extraordinary in different ways, and the commonality between them is how much they have gone through because they have refused to forget, and just the cost to their personal lives for refusing to forget. So I'm going to go back now to talk to that forgotten crackdown, which I mentioned at the beginning. Crackdown which was forgotten in the West, in China, and even in the city where it happened, which is the city of Chengdu. And you can see it's kind of in the middle of the map. It's 1,100 miles from Beijing. So just to give you some context, it wasn't just in Beijing where there were protests. There were protests in dozens of cities, probably hundreds of cities around China. And in Chengdu as well, tens of thousands of people took to the streets. People from government work units joined. These are workers from the Meteorology Bureau here. And delegations came to join the protests from as far afield as Tibetan areas. And there was a square in Chengdu as well. It was different from Tiananmen Square because it had a statue of Chairman Mao. But it became known as Little Tiananmen. And in Chengdu, so many people went to protest that instead of saying, "Have you eaten yet?" which is a very common Chinese greeting, people used to say, "Have you demonstrated yet?" I should say at this point that all these pictures were sent to me by people who were there at the time in order to try and find out what had happened in Chengdu. I tried to track down people who had been there at the time. And actually today in the audience, I think there's a very important person who helped me a lot, Dr. Hatterer, who sitting at the back, thank you for coming, who was there in 1989 and wrote a letter to the editor of the New York Times. And that was one of the very first places that I found sort of documentary proof. You know, it was really one of the very important starting points for me in trying to discover what had happened. But all of these pictures were sent by people who were there, and that by the time that I finished, I had more than 1,000 pictures of the events in Chengdu that day, as well as all kinds of diaries and reports like the one that Dr. Hatterer wrote, and diplomatic cables and Chinese government reports saying what had happened there. So there was a hunger strike in Chengdu as well. And the students occupied the square, and at one point as many as 1,700 students took part in that hunger strike. But by the beginning of June, interest was slightly beginning to wane in Chengdu and people were beginning to go home. But then on June the 4th, the crackdown happened in Beijing and everything changed. In Chengdu on June the 4th, thousands of people came out onto the streets to protest. This time they were protesting against the crackdown itself. And if you read Chinese, you'll see that one of those signs says, June the 4th massacre, 7,000 killed and injured. And this was a mourning wreath, the traditional mourning wreath that the protesters were carrying. And the sign on that says, we are not afraid to die. So these protests really were very brave, because the people who were protesting knew that soldiers with guns had been sent to put down protests in Beijing, and yet they still came out to protest. And there was a crackdown, the inevitable crackdown. In Chengdu, it was slightly different, because it was not the army, it was the military police, the armed police, that were deployed. And they used tear gas and water cannon to begin with. You can see that here. This enraged the crowds, and very soon these kind of pitched battles started between the crowds and the police. And the crowds were mostly throwing stones and paving stones and bottles and anything they could lay their hands on at the police. And these continued for 3 days and three nights, sort of on and off around the city. And here again, you can see the fighting that took place. And this picture is interesting to me, because you can see how the police, how they responded. And I'll just show you, I blew up the middle of the picture. And you can see there's a policeman with a baton, and there's a protester kneeling in the middle of that shot. And that really shows the police strategy, which was not to use guns, but to use clubs, batons, to beat protesters. And they beat people very brutally indeed. This was another picture taken that day, which shows how the crowds parted in order to allow these bicycle rickshaws to take wounded people to hospital. It looks just like the pictures from Beijing, but this, again, as with all the pictures I've been showing you, was from Chengdu. And these pictures were taken inside one of the hospitals in Chengdu. And I find this picture to be very striking, because you can just see this look of just disbelief and shock, because people really weren't expecting it. These are pictures of some of the injured that day. And it is interesting, because you can see the preponderance of head injuries. The government strategy was really to beat protesters around the heads. You know, there are just lines of people with their heads bandaged. And the government didn't try to hide what had happened. It couldn't, because Chengdu's geography was such that so many people saw what had happened. It was impossible to hide it. So again, they used the same strategy. They released a book, and this is the book. It's called The Whole Story of the Chengdu Riots. And it was released just a month later in July 1989, 700,000 copies, so everybody could find out what the government's side of the story was. What was interesting to me was, in this book, they admitted that people had died that day. They said 8 people died, including 2 students, and 1,800 people sought treatment, including more than 1,000 policemen. Although they said that the injuries had been quite light. Those figures are very low. The American consulate, who was on the scene and who were at the square and who were watching very carefully, told the New York Times that at least 100 seriously wounded people were carried out of the square at that time. But shocking though it was that people had died in Chengdu and that this didn't emerge at the time, this was actually not the most bloody event that happened in Chengdu in 1989. That was to happen the very next day. So after the initial crackdown, people were very unhappy. And they took revenge on the state by setting fire and attacking anything that belonged to the state. So this was the remainder of a market which had taken up an entire city block. And that was burnt down to the ground. Buses and police vehicles were also set fire to. And by the next morning, police had actually withdrawn from the streets and were sheltering in a municipal compound because they'd actually lost control completely. The consul general at the time told me he remembered that when he went out on the streets the next day, even the traffic lights weren't working. He said it was like the state had disappeared overnight. So what happened next has not really been told before. But one of the sources that I drew upon was actually diplomatic cables from that consulate, from the US Consul General, who was based in the Jinjiang Hotel where these events happen. And as you see, the title, the subject line is Chengdu protests become mob riots. So this is a picture of the Jinjiang Hotel. And this is where the US Consul was, his office was and his residence was. And when a lot of the trouble broke out, many foreigners went to the US Consul General and sheltered in his residence at the back of a hotel. And this hotel actually came under attack at one point. This mob of people broke in and started ransacking the shop in the lobby, and police were called in to restore order. And the Westerners were all sheltering in the residence of the Consul General at the back of the hotel. And after a certain time, they were told that order had been restored and they could return to their rooms. So many of them went back to the front of the hotel. And they, as they went back to their rooms at the front of the hotel, they saw this very odd sight. And many of them struggled for a while to understand what they were seeing and to process it, because it was not what they were expecting. They saw lines of people kneeling in the courtyard in the front of the hotel. And their hands had been wired or tied behind their backs, the protesters, who were kneeling in lines. So they were completely incapacitated. And there were these plainclothes policemen that were sort of going up and down the lines of the people. And at a certain point, an order was given, and the protesters were thrown one by one, really brutally, to the ground. And then plainclothes policemen went round and with these batons and clubs smashed each protester over the head. After several hours, two trucks pulled in, and the bodies of the protesters were thrown into trucks. Like garbage, like sacks of potato, like slabs of meat, like carcasses. Those are different descriptions from different witnesses. And the thing was that each of the witnesses that I spoke to didn't know that anyone else had seen the same thing that they had seen. And time again, I would hear this sort of shock and surprise when I said, oh, somebody else saw that and described it like this. And they would say, I thought I was the only one. Someone said, I don't remember anyone screaming. This was one of the witnesses. There was no noise, just the bodies piling on top of each other. There were definitely lifeless bodies. I imagined if anyone was alive, they would not survive in that pile. So I went back to Chinese sources to try and find some more confirmation. And sure enough, in the whole story of the Chengdu riots, they confirmed that 70 people had been detained that night at that hotel. And the newspapers also confirmed, newspaper reports at the time, confirmed that violence had been used by police against protesters. But if you were to ask me what happened, did people die that night, and did all of them die, I can't tell you. Too long has passed, and too much is unknown. I mean, what I do know is that the people who were there, the eyewitnesses that I spoke to, believed that they witnessed an atrocity. Many of them, when they Afterwards, they went back to their own countries and they went to the press, like Dr. Hushra, who wrote a letter to the editor of the New York Times, which was titled, which was given the title of Chengdu Had Its Own Tiananmen Massacre. Some of the eyewitnesses also went to Amnesty International. But the problem was that no one was really listening. Although Amnesty wrote about it, and although the New York Times printed the letter, what happened in Beijing was so much bigger that it kind of dwarfed everything else. And of course, there were no pictures. The press, the international press, while they were in Tiananmen with their cameras rolling, they weren't in Chengdu. And so people began to forget what had happened. And those. But when I went and I looked at the Chinese accounts, I was really interested to see pictures of the roundup of protesters. Now, these weren't pictures from the Jingjiang Hotel, but they were pictures from the same time. And what interested me was just how similar the scenes they show were to the descriptions that I'd had from people who'd never seen these pictures. So in this picture, you can see people being loaded into a police van. And then in this picture, you can see people being rounded up, made to kneel. You can see their hands are tied together. And if you look in the background, you can see people who have been forced to lie flat on the ground, face down, and their hands are tied behind their backs. So to me, these pictures, the value that they have is that they mirror so closely the accounts that I was given. So could people have died and no one know? That question brought me back to Tang Diying, the mother who I spoke about in the beginning, who lost her son in 1989. She had been told by someone else who'd been detained at the same time that her son had been beaten to death in police custody. And she wanted to find out more. So she has spent the last quarter of a century trying to find more answers. She tried to go to Beijing 5 times. Each time she was caught and sent back to Chengdu. She was detained, she was beaten. 2 times she was locked in an iron cage. And she had a police car stationed outside her home for 2 entire years. But after 11 years, her persistence had a very surprising result. She was actually, by police, given a photograph of her son's corpse. He was lying on a cement floor, and you could see blood around his nostrils and his mouth. You could see a bruise on his nose, and his face was swollen and uneven, and one of his eyes was open, and she told me when she saw that, she fainted because she thought, my son is looking at me even in death. In 2006, she was given a payment, and she's the first person to have been paid in connection with a 1989 death. She was paid almost $9,000, although it was not called compensation, it was called a hardship allowance, and she was told, it was made clear to her that there was a quid pro quo. She was supposed to stop asking questions. But being the very persistent, very determined person that she is, she refused to stop asking questions, although she did take the money. But when I asked her, so were there other people who died when your son died? Were there others whose relatives, like you, have been unable to find them? She just looked at me, and she looked me straight in the eyes, and she said, even if I knew, I wouldn't tell you. And I was shocked, because this woman is such a fighter. And she spent a quarter of a century trying to get those answers, and she's been through so much to try and find answers. And it made me realize, if she couldn't give me an answer, then who would? So answers are hard to come by. What we do know is that what happened in Chengdu was very nearly the perfect case study in first rewriting history and then deleting it entirely. Because there was no foreign footage, and because the victims were silenced by force or by fear, because the foreign witnesses were removed from the scene almost immediately, and because nobody actually cared that much. Even though people who were there tried to tell the outside world, nobody paid that much attention. And the party knew that what happened existed in memory alone. And it knew that memories are mutable, even the memories of tens of thousands of people, millions of people. Because I would argue that forgetting is not something that is imposed from above. It's something that people have cooperated with and colluded with because they feel they have no choice. In China today, it is not convenient to remember what happened on June the 4th, 1989. Not in Chengdu, not in Beijing, nowhere in China. There's no benefit to memory. There's only a very big cost. And I'm going to tell you one more story to illustrate that. And that's the story of this man. He's an artist, and his name is Sheng Qi. And he was not in Tiananmen Square on June the 4th, 1989. He was in his hometown. But he was very sympathetic to the students. And when he heard what had happened, that the army had been sent in, he described it almost as if he had lost his mind, as if his senses had taken leave of him for a period of time. And he was almost deranged. And he took a meat cleaver, a kitchen cleaver, and as an act of protest, he chopped off his little finger. You can see that in the picture. And for years, he used his mutilated hand to make art. This photograph he called Myself. So it was for him part of his repertoire for years. But now, 25 years later, things are a little bit different. And he has a 12-year-old son. And so I asked him, I said, what did you tell your son about what happened to your finger? And he looked a little bit shamefaced. And he said, well, actually, I normally tell him that I left it on the bus. And I said, well, he can't believe that. You know, he's 12 years old. And he said, I know he doesn't believe it. But I'm always just making up funny stories to tell him because he's still a kid and I need to protect him. And that is how people feel in China today, that their children need protection from the truth, that in order to succeed and thrive in today's China, not knowing what happened in 1989 is important for their children. And you might ask, well, does it really matter? 25 years have passed. China is now the world's second biggest economy, and it has raised millions, tens of millions of people out of poverty in that time. Does it really matter what happened in 1989? And I would say, yes, it does matter. It matters because history matters. And history matters so much to the Chinese government that it is willing to spend all this money and all these human resources muzzling people like Tang Deying, who wanted to find out what happened to her son. That's because the Chinese government is scared of its own history. In the West, we like to buy into the idea that economic progress in China has led to political openness. And it is true, China is richer and it is freer than it was in 1989. There's no question about that. But there are limits, like 1989. And the cover-up has not just happened at the top. Memory, which is really, it's the most personal of spaces, it's inside your own head. But memory has become political, it's become a political tool, and people have colluded with that. They've allowed themselves to be party to state-sponsored amnesia. As one dissident put it, in China today, the crimes of the state are being replaced by the crime of silence. And that is a crime in which almost everyone is complicit. Thank you.
We will have the ability to take some questions from the audience, but we're going to start with some questions electronically. On the screens, you can see how to submit a question if you want. But if Louisa, you want to take a couple from there, and then we'll take some from the audience
sure.
as well.
So this question, I don't know if you can all see it. How much have the Tiananmen mothers affected the role of government censorship? And I would say that Tiananmen mothers have played a very important role in China. I mean, they're one of the first political pressure groups, and they're a very important moral force. I don't know if they've affected government censorship that much, because I don't think that many people inside China have heard of them. I think they're very well known among certain circles, but if you went to the countryside and you went to talk to, you know, an average farmer, he wouldn't be able to tell you who the Tiananmen mothers are. I would say that where they've made the difference is outside China. I think people watch very carefully what happened to the Tiananmen mothers, and they also read their statements very carefully, which are almost like a yardstick of the political climate in China. So this year was the very first year that the Tiananmen mothers have not been able to issue a statement. Normally, every year, they will issue two statements, one when the legislature meets and one just before June the 4th. And this year, I think it's the first time since 1995, since they started writing statements, that they were not able to issue a statement because they were all detained or under house arrest. So I think that they have played a very big role as a moral force, almost like the mothers of the disappeared in Argentina. That would be, I think, the best parallel. So there's another question here. Do you still have China press credentials, or were they yanked after your book? My press credentials ran out at the end of last year. So I left China in the summer, and they ran out at the end of the year. Normally, you have to get them renewed in December. And because I wasn't in China, I didn't try to get them renewed. So I don't have Chinese press credentials, but they haven't been taken away from me. They've just lapsed because I wasn't there. Now,
of all the people you interviewed, are you aware of any that suffered consequences as a result?
I mean, as I said in the presentation, there were two people there was the artist who is still in detention, but I don't know whether, I think there were other factors as well, such as his performance. I think it's difficult. Most of the people that I interviewed have spoken over a number of years to the press on a number of issues, not just on this. And some of them were taken in this year and were questioned and detained, but it wasn't clear whether it was for the book or for other things, like the meeting that you saw or the piece of performance art that you saw. But all of them, you know, we went through a process where before we even started talking, I said, do you want to be interviewed? And do you want me to use your real names? And they said yes. I was very careful. So while I was working on the book, I didn't talk about it at home or in my office, because they were all in this one diplomatic compound that everybody believes is bugged. So I never talked about it. I didn't even tell my children for really a long time, because I was worried that they're quite small, and I was worried they might sort of just let it slip. And I didn't ever talk about the book on the phone or in emails, because I was worried that these were bugged as well. So, you know, often I would arrange to see someone, but I would not tell them what I was doing until I got there. And in each case, they agreed to have their names used, and they, you know, they agreed to tell me their stories. And I think, you know, I don't think a single person met me and said, don't write about me. I think that in many cases, people just thought, well, 25 years has passed. And, you know, we haven't been able to tell our own stories. Are we actually going to get a chance? You know, maybe this is the chance that we should take. But, and for me, after they had spoken to me, I felt that I had a duty to tell their stories. And I hope that there will be no consequences, but, you know, it was a really very hard decision for me as well, because, you know, you're trying to make a calculation in a vacuum. You really don't know what's happening. And, you know, when you're talking to people, we're trying to imagine, well, what will the political climate be like down the line when the book comes out? And that's a question that no one could answer. So, you know, there were a lot of hard decisions, and I hope that people haven't had consequences, but it's difficult to say.
Hi.
Hi.
If I remember, right before the Tiananmen Square situation, Gorbachev was there.
Mm.
And I'm just wondering, and then he leaves, and then Currents did, and I remember with my acquaintances and business associates in Moscow, this is a little bit later, that they had heard that the Chinese had nothing but contempt for Gorbachev for being weak and the whole perestroika and glasnost and the eventual collapse of the Soviet Union. So that being said, do you think that then and all the way to the present that the Chinese sort of have a backward glance of what happened to the Soviet Union and are actually concerned even to this day that this could happen to them, even continuing on sixth or seventh generation of corruption in the Communist Party?
Yes. Yes, is my answer, I think. I mean, I think the Chinese have watched this, the experience, the Russian experience, really very closely. And they studied what happened after 1989. And they've kind of, quite subtly, they've made use of it in Chinese propaganda as well. So it's often a line that you hear from people defending the government's actions in 1989. You know, they say, well, look what happened to Russia, and look how much better we're doing. You know, if the government hadn't done what they did, then we might be like Russia today. So I think that kind of, that has really played into the government's justification for its own behavior. But it did watch very closely. And I mean, I think that there were certain things that in the post-89 period, the government was very concerned about. So they looked at the Russian experience and the Eastern European experience, and one of the factors that they saw that they believed had played a role was the role of non-governmental organizations, particularly NGOs funded by the West. And so, you know, for many years after 1989, it was really very difficult for Chinese NGOs to get off the ground and also to sort of cooperate with Western organizations because of this whole fear of, in China they call it the color revolutions and the role of NGOs there. And when it comes to corruption as well, you know, that was another thing that they watched and, you know, they tracked, and they're always saying that they're cracking down upon. And now, you know, this year we've seen a very big crackdown against corruption. But I think, you know, people in China don't really believe that the government, I mean, they know how deep the corruption is. So, you know, in many cases, even though the government says, oh, we're cracking down on corruption, people often, they believe that this is just cover for, you know, taking out political enemies. And that, you know, was another of the legacies of 1989, is that, you know, the government credibility is so very low if the government says one thing, people tend to believe the opposite, because they lived through 1989 and through seeing sort of these stories being rewritten and rewritten and rewritten in front of their eyes. Yes. I mean, they're slightly subtler than rubbing people out. They used to do that. Nowadays, they're slightly subtler, but yes, it is from similar playbook.
Want to go back to just a couple of electronic ones there?
So there's a question. Tell us about protests in other cities, Shanghai, Guangzhou, Harbin, etc. So there were protests in dozens of other cities around China, and in most cases, they were diffused without violence. But we do know that there were a couple of other cities, I think it was Changsha and Xi'an, where there was some violence. And in most cases, it wasn't opening fire. It was like Chengdu beating protesters. And we know there was some loss of life, both in Changsha and in Xi'an. This question says, there was a replica of Lady Liberty in the square. What significance did it have for the protesters and the government? So this refers to the statue of the goddess of democracy that was raised in Tiananmen Square at the very beginning of June. And it was made by art students from the Central Academy of Art, which was right next to the square. And it was enormously important, actually. It was really, it became, you know, just for those few days before the crackdown, it became a symbol that rallied protesters. So it did manage to, it was one of the things that managed to bring the student movement, which had been flagging a bit at that point, back to life. And for the government as well, it was clearly important for the government because it was one of the things that the army troops did when they came to the square, which was run it down and knock it over. And the soldier who became an artist, interestingly, he later went to that same art school with the students who'd made that statue. And I asked him whether he told anyone who he was. And he said that at the time he didn't talk about his past at all. Can anyone purchase your book in China online? Has it been translated? I would love it to be translated. It has not been translated. You can buy it on Kindle. I don't know if you can buy it on Kindle in China. I do know that The Economist magazine had a big review of my book, which took up an entire page of The Economist. And when that issue appeared on people's doorsteps in China, the page with the book review had been torn out. So I'm guessing you can't buy my book in China. I also heard from a friend who had bought a copy of my book and had wrapped it up in birthday paper and sent it to a friend in China, not through the post, but through their office. And they said that it never made it. So hopefully someone somewhere in China is reading that.
Thank you very much. It was a terrific talk, and thank you for sharing that information. About 3 weeks ago, I was in China for a 2.5-week traveling seminar led by a professor at Pepperdine. And he had led that trip for the past 25 years and was in China in 1989 helping some people go away from that area. One of the interesting facts that he shared with us was that the Chinese had imported some soldiers and troops from Mongolia to help clear out Tiananmen Square. And one of the reasons for that was because they didn't quite understand what was going on, and they didn't speak the same language. So they were able to manipulate those soldiers to maybe do things that their soldiers wouldn't do or couldn't do. Did you come across any research or anyone talk about Mongolian soldiers being in that area or even in Chengdu?
Well, they were from Inner Mongolia, right? I know I don't know about, you know, exactly which troops were from where, but I do know that many of the martial law troops were from outside Beijing. So what had happened was, on the first attempt to impose martial law around May the 20th, one of the commanders of the most elite troops based in Beijing, the 38th Army, had actually refused. He said, I'm not sending in my troops. And so, because he was a very important person and his you know, regiment was considered to be one of the most loyal, this raised big questions about the loyalty of the army. And that man, Major General Xu Qingxian, was sent to prison for 5 years. And, you know, he was removed from his position immediately, but the government learned lessons from that. And then when it came to the second time, they made sure that many of the troops were from outside Beijing. And they, in many cases, I heard from soldiers that they'd switched their leadership just before. And in many cases, like Chen Guang's case, they were very young soldiers. And they'd spent a very large amount of time having ideological education before they were deployed in. So they were brought to Beijing and kept on the outskirts. And every day they just had to, you know, they had newspapers read aloud to them, the People's Liberation Army daily. And they were told over and over again, you know, how bad these protests were and how they were being manipulated by Western hostile elements and this kind of thing. So they were really, you know, almost brainwashed in order to ensure their loyalty. And so that was, I don't know about Mongolian or Inner Mongolian troops, but I do know that that was the case for many, many of the units that were brought in.
I have a question regarding technology that might overcome these limitations. Is there nothing yet that can be done to enable spreading of truth technologically over their blocking?
So, I mean, there is the internet, and there are ways of getting around government censorship. So a lot of young Chinese people know how to use, there's something called a VPN, a virtual private network, and it's almost like a channel, which means that you can bypass government blocks. And a lot of people, young people, do know how to use this and use it regularly. But that was why I was so surprised when I went to the universities, because these young kids in the universities, they're the smartest kids in China. These are people who absolutely know how to use the internet, and they know how to use these VPNs to bypass censorship. If they wanted to do it, they would know how. So that's why I think that in a way we have underestimated the ability of the Chinese government to erase history, because it's like these young people have this sort of inbuilt censorship in their own minds. They're not even looking at political things. And it's not because they're scared. It's because, you know, they believe that politics is dangerous. And they believe, you know, it's just better to steer clear of politics. And so, you know, they'll go online, but they just believe that what happened in 1989, you know, is something that's, you know, better for them not to find out about. One person, one young man, he said to me, I don't really have a view on 1989 because I'm not a historian or an archaeologist. But that's how young people think. They think that it's ancient history, which has nothing to do with their lives. And I mean, that was really why I wrote this book, because I thought that it was a book that needed to be written because nobody talks about it. And even in the West, I think there is some worry that, you know, oh, you might get blacklisted, oh, you might never get allowed back in. And so I think people really aren't talking about these huge issues, which really should be remembered. Otherwise, they will be forgotten. But thank you for your question.
Well, You probably don't know that Louisa grew up in Hong Kong and to a father who is Chinese and a mother who is English, if I'm not mistaken, and has worked in Beijing for the last 10 years, a place that she considers the journalistic mecca for all the things that are going on there. So are you going to be able to go back? Where are you now? What's your future?
I don't know whether I'll be able to go back. I hope that I will, but it may not happen for some years. I'm just finishing up a fellowship at the University of Michigan, and we will see. We will see.
It's been a fascinating talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so much.
Please buy her book, and she will sign copies. Thank you all for coming.